So this is the second part of Advance. It's called Changing the World. Question for you. Do you know that you're called to do that?
Yes.
I know Caitlin Burke is. Do you know there's like an actual mark on your life for that? There's a purpose, there's a destiny on you to change the world. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
Amen.
Really? I want to say right off the bat this morning, for every single person listening, you are absolutely, completely equipped and able to impact this world and to change it for the good. We're focusing on the word advance because we're talking about advancing God's kingdom in this world. And that changes the world. Now, if you've paid any attention over the last few weeks, you would recognize that we're not really so much advancing the kingdom. That's the word we chose to use. But we're really more revealing a kingdom that's already here. So I won't go over all that again. We've pretty made it pretty clear that the kingdom of God is love, it's unity, it's family. It's already available for all who would take hold of it. So the terminology isn't that important. The point is that we get to participate in bringing others into the awareness and the experience of the kingdom. So quick refresher, last week we talked about what the kingdom of God is. We talked about the cross that's at the center of all of it. Today, I want to talk specifically about your calling to impact this world and what it really means to change the world, because that is a buzz term, buzz phrase that gets thrown around and maybe a little overused. So I want to hone in on that a little bit. How does changing the world really happen? And I want to get some ancient wisdom from Jesus and his apostles, because I think they might know a little bit something about changing the world, huh? Just a little bit? A little bit. So why don't we do this? Let's pray also. The Lord Jesus is with you right now in love and confidence, in joy. I just want you to keep that in your heart whenever we pray. Father, thank you so much. Jesus, thank you so much for your presence with us and your constant faithfulness and ability and grace to complete the good work you've started in our lives, Lord, to bring to completion everything that you have planned for us, everything that you have purposed for us, everything that you had marked us out for from before the foundation of the world, Lord Jesus, that you are with us to carry us through into the fullness of that promise. We receive that, Lord. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your love here today and your kindness, your gentleness to just lead us as a shepherd, to guide us as our Lord, and lead us into those promises, those callings, into the full joy that that brings. So, Jesus, I pray that you would use this time, however you see fit, to continue to ignite the spark of love and passion and confidence in our hearts to truly see ourselves as ones who can, who will make an impact, Lord, who will bring change. So, Holy Spirit, I pray your presence just fill this time, consume us, and be our teacher this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So, each of you are like hidden superheroes in this world. Each one of you. You are. I know that might sound ridiculously corny to some of you, but there's a reason that these movies, superhero movies, and the stories behind them make millions upon billions of dollars. People flock to them, and they buy memorabilia about them. And we've been telling these stories since the days of ancient mythology because this speaks to something really deep in our hearts, like really core. It's real. There's something that this uncovers within us. It inspires us because it's an echo of what we were made to be, what we are made to be. There's this glory inside of you. And as you wake up, as you awake, as you let go of fear and self-loathing and worry, the false identity, all the stuff we've been going over. In other words, as you learn to get over yourself, realize you died with Christ. There's a new life to live in Him, in love. Well, you get to go out and share that glory with the world. And we, as the church, as sons and daughters of God growing together, we have been chosen by God for this very purpose. Chosen by God. Can you just let that hit for a moment? That you've been chosen? Now, let me make something very clear before we move forward with this calling of changing the world. The word chosen is a loaded word. I want to purify the waters a little bit. Some people hear that word, and it can have a very religious feel to it, almost like an us versus them kind of feel, which, you know, we've been breaking down extensively. But some Christians, in fact, many, many Christians believe in the same way that many other exclusive belief systems of this world believe, where we think that being chosen means that we are the ones who receive the favor and the mercy of God, which ultimately leads to the fact that we get to go to heaven while the rest of the world gets to burn forever and bring God glory through that somehow in some sick way. Now, of course, people who teach this dress it up really nice, a lot nicer than I just said it. But I just like to strip some of these bare naked so you can get a good hard look at it, you know. But this is really what a lot of people believe, including many good and honest Christians, maybe some of you. So this is what I want to make very clear. If someone is chosen by God, that means that they have been chosen, not instead of the world, but on behalf of the world. In other words, we have been chosen to help others discover the love and goodness of the Father. We have been elected. You heard that word before? The elect? Well, we are elected, like an elected official is supposed to serve the community around her or him. We are the elect, we are the called, we are the chosen, who get to help other people discover their true identity as well. So I want you to look at what the Apostle Paul says about being chosen in Colossians. He's talking to a group of believers in this letter that he wrote, and he addresses them very firmly and lovingly as a chosen people. But look at how he says they are to express this chosenness. He says in Colossians 3, verse 12, "So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience." Now, those words right there are very relational words. Those words have to do with how we treat others. And Paul makes it very clear in another letter that we are to do good to all people, not just our household of faith. That's where it starts. It's very important because as we build up our family, we're able to bless the families of the earth. But Paul makes it clear, we're to do good to all people. Now, look at what Jesus said when he addressed a group of his disciples. These were followers of his who he gave a very powerful calling to. And I want you to remember something, side note, as we read scriptures like this, okay? God preserved the words of Christ for thousands of years through the sweat and the literal blood of people who've gone before us to preserve the Bible when it's been fought over and suppressed over centuries and centuries. We have these words because Jesus, when we read what we're about to read, Jesus was not just speaking to a group of people on an Israeli hillside. He was speaking to us as well. So this is Jesus still alive speaking to you. You are on that hillside right now listening to the words of Christ, preserved in Scripture because God wanted it to reach you this morning. That's a wild thought, but it's a beautiful thought, and we can really let it soak into us as though we can just feel the breeze and we can hear the rabbi's words being carried across the wind, spoken right to us, making eye contact with us. This is for us personally. So he said this. He said, "You are the light of the world." I love Jesus' confidence in us, you know? Don't argue with him either. He knows what he's talking about. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. He goes on and says, "Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." Let your light shine. That's the light of Christ in us, right? Let it shine so that, this is the conclusion, the result of this, so that others may see it and then glorify your Father. That's the result of us living as this holy and beloved people, as Paul said. Others in the world will see this, and what will happen is they'll end up glorifying God. Our calling is to impact others in such a way that they glorify God. Now, let me tell you something. That doesn't mean that people will give God a little thumbs up here and there when you do a good deed for them. Glorifying God means something much deeper than that, something radical. Let me show you something. In his letter to the Romans, Paul laid out this really important foundational teaching in the first and second chapter about the fall of mankind, how mankind fell away from God. And he says, right in the first chapter, in verse 21, that we glorified him not. Man glorified him not. That was the problem. Here it is. "Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened." So they stopped glorifying God. They stop being thankful. What happens when you let your light shine and bless others? People become thankful again. There's a connection there. But what I really want to focus on is that word glorify. They stop glorifying him as God. If you keep reading this, you'll learn what that looked like. They started worshiping idols. They started following all these wicked and destructive paths. Really bad stuff started to happen in the world. So make the connection here, okay? If people see our good works and then glorify God, that means that they are doing what they were originally created to do. They are returning to their true purpose and to their true identity as well. Do you see what Jesus is getting at here? This is huge. This is really big. This is saying, he's saying this to me and to you, all of us here. He's saying, "You are the light. You've been chosen, you're holy and beloved. Now let your light shine, and through a living faith, reveal your identity in me. Take off the Clark Kent suit and be who you are." What will happen is that people will see it. They'll simply see it. They'll be able to touch it and feel it and hear it as well. And it will cause them to glorify God. Therefore, the world will change back to what it was meant to be in the beginning. Eden will be restored. The kingdom will advance. Are you with me? This is why we've been chosen. We're not more special than other people. We're helping others to see their specialness as well by pointing the way for them. We're like stars in the night. We're like a compass for humanity. We're a lighthouse. I'll shout it from the rooftops if I have to. Glory. So Jesus compares the church to a lit up city on a hill. Exclamation mark, everybody. Pay attention. At the end of the Bible, end of the very end, I'm talking Revelation chapter 22, okay? This image comes up again. The Apostle John sees you. What? You know you're in the Bible? He sees you. He sees the bride of Christ. But how does he see us? What does he see? What is it? Anybody remember? Come on, don't tell me you haven't read the end of the book. We're all going to jump ahead to that one. What does he see coming out of the sky? A city. Thank you. He sees a city filled with light. Sounds a little familiar, right? To Jesus' words? Okay, that's because God has a point he's trying to make throughout the whole Bible. There's one author of that book, ultimately. Now, I want to hone in on one aspect of this city at the end of the book. This is from Revelation 22, and this is the second verse. There's this street in the middle of the city, and the street is also a river. This is a vision. Okay, this is a metaphor. Again, God is painting a picture for us, okay? This is what he sees, and he writes down. In the middle of its street, the city street, and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Now, a lot of people read Revelation 22, and they think that this is the end. This is the end of history. This is like the happily ever after part. And I understand why we think that, because it's at the end, and typically at the end, it's the end of the story. But if you really think about it, that doesn't really make sense. Because if this is happily ever after, Christ has returned, Armageddon has happened, all these things, you know, we know about end times, it's all over, it's all past, it's at the very end, it's all good, then why are there leaves with a purpose to heal the nations? It seems like people in this vision, still in the world, are not living happily ever after. Because there's healing available to them. The city has a tree with leaves that are for the healing of the nations. This is showing us in the vision that the nations are not yet healed. So this is partly talking about the church's present day calling. This is actually talking about you. And if you read the vision more, this city has gates. Are the gates open or closed? Anybody remember? Open. The gates are wide open, day and night. So anyone and everyone is welcomed into this city. It says, if they wash their robes in the blood of the Lamb. In other words, if they receive the gracious gift already poured out in Christ. So, this has elements of the future in it, but this is definitely talking about the church today. We are that city on a hill. We are a wondrous community of light and precious stones. And I pray that your heart sees that more in yourself and in the person next to you and the person next to them. This was a heavenly vision. This is John going up higher, seeing from a higher perspective than we often see when we focus on our issues and problems. Plenty of naysayers out there, right? Plenty of people that want to rip apart the church, and often for good reason, because there's been a lot of stupid stuff that has happened to people who claim the name of Christ. I get it, but I don't want to be in the naysayers anymore. I was at one point. I want a higher perspective to see the bride of Christ as this vision here, because this is talking about now. Okay? Now, within this church, within the community, the present church, there is a tree of life in the center. The tree of life is Jesus Christ himself, and it's his gospel. We are the branches on the tree, though. Did you know that? That's actually just quoting from another passage from John, who had this vision, right? John, in his gospel, he quotes Jesus himself, where Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. You're the branches on this tree of life, this vine of life. But look what he goes on to say after. He says, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. Oh, you seeing a pattern here? The fruit of our lives, right? Or the leaves of our lives? Whatever picture you want to use, God uses different images, but it's all pointing to the same thing. The fruit and leaves of our lives bring healing to the nations. Question for you, what is that fruit? What are the leaves? What's the fruit of our lives? Yeah, yes. What is the fruit of the Spirit? I hear it whispering. Shout it forth. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, right? It's all that stuff Paul said before, right? As people chosen of God, right? Holy and beloved, put on these things. Walk in them, because that's who you are. Because as you do that, Jesus' dad gets glorified on earth, which also means the nations get healed. Do you realize the power that you carry inside of you? By simply letting your little light shine. This is not some cute little Sunday school message, folks. Right now, the nations are sick. Pay attention to me. On my iPhone, when I was working on this message on Friday, I got that Amber Alert that went out. Right? There was an Amber Alert, which, if you don't know what that is, when a child is abducted, law enforcement reaches out for our help to spot the vehicle that the child is believed to be in. This was a young girl whose life was in danger. There is something sick in this world, right? There's something wrong with that. That's not right. That is not bringing glory to Jesus' dad by any means. Right now, children are being abused every day. And women and men are being forced into slave labor in this world, into sexual labor, forced into that. Right now, families are being broken up all the time because of addictions, because of greed, because of the insecurities of life, of people not knowing who they are, and fear. People right now are dying in our streets. They're dying in our own streets from overdosing on heroin, probably because they're looking to numb the pain of this sickness they feel inside. We're not just throwing around nice-sounding Bible passages or some lovely little ditty on, you know, letting our light shine just to fill time on a Sunday morning. These scriptures, these truths and realities, they carry extreme relevance to the world around us. The world that hits you when you turn on your phone, when you walk out on the street, this world of Amber Alerts and sex trafficking and divorce and heroin. This world is sick, but the good, the beautiful news is that there is a cure. Come on, somebody smile at that one. There is good news. There's good news that there's medicine. And we've been chosen by the grace of God to bring that healing. We have the medicine flowing through us if we just believe it, right? And embrace that. We have to let this hit us in the deepest of places, guys. We are chosen through and through. Not in spite of the world, right? But because of the world. We're marked and sealed in love to be a blessing. God said to Abraham, I will bless you that you might be a blessing to all the families of the earth. We have that same call of Abraham on us because God wants to help the sick. He really does. And he wants people everywhere to discover this same city of light and enter its gates and be cleansed of the lies and the pain. People can enter those gates at any moment. I shared the story last week when I entered those gates and how much it radically washed me clean, changed the robes that I was wearing. And that's what's beautiful and hopeful about Revelation 22. This is for now. And people will be drawn to those gates of heaven through the light that's on us. Never doubt that. Never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus, because it's the very medicine people need. Don't be ashamed of this message. Can you imagine walking into a clinic and being, you know, having like a cure for some disease that people are lining up at the door for, and being worried if they'll like you or not? Meanwhile, you have the vial in your hand that's going to set them free. All right, if you have spent any time in church or Christian circles, you're probably familiar with these terms right here. Missions and evangelism, right? These are words that have to do with the church's mission to spread this medicine, the gospel. Now, I want to clarify something else here. A lot of Awake, Arise, Advance is really about changing our thinking. It's getting fresh perspective on things we already know very well, or should be common things if we are involved in those circles. But some people talk about missions and evangelism, and they talk about it as though it's just kind of going out and converting people so that they can go to heaven when they die. That's how it's presented. But in light of what we just saw in the scriptures and what we've been teaching, obviously our calling is much, much bigger than that. Through Christ, we're not called to convert the world. We're called to change the world, transform the world. Now, I know some people would say that maybe that's an issue of semantics and, you know, isn't it kind of the same thing? There really is a difference, and I'll try to explain what I mean by this before someone gets too offended. There are many churches and Christian organizations that base their success upon how many people walk through the door, how many new families come into the register, and, you know, how many people prayed a prayer to receive Jesus. And hours and hours and hours of time is spent, and a lot of money is spent to collect this data. And a lot of times, funding and resources will go back to the places based on that data, okay? Numbers. And I really believe that very often, that is an incredible waste of time and focus. Now, I won't make that a blanket statement, because it's not all the time. I don't want to make that a whole negative thing. But I think we should really be asking different questions. Like, not how many people came through the door, but how many people in our community are whole spiritually, emotionally, physically even? How many fathers are spending time with their kids? How about that question for a survey of church growth? How many mothers are doing the same thing? How many marriages are healthy and thriving? And how many people are falling in love with Jesus Christ, which you can't really quantify? So I guess we can't do the numbers all the time. So I hope that makes sense. Our calling is to transform the way this world operates. We're not just adding numbers to a register. Does that make sense? Give me a nod if you're tracking with me. So this calling involves every area of life, every area of life. So our chosenness, what we're called to do, it involves not just church and not even just families, that's where it starts, but it also includes governments and education systems and media and businesses. All of that is part of our focus, because that is where the world lives and breathes. And the whole world is meant to be saturated with the cross of Jesus. Remember, Jesus said to his disciples, "Go and you make disciples of all nations." All nations. There is this picture there of the full nation. I'm not going to get into all that. We've talked about it before. But he says to them, "Baptize people in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." And of course, that means to be immersed, baptized into our original identity, into the family of the Trinity, right? We are called to bring people into their sonship, their daughterhood, as the beloved children of God, made in the image of love. That's the mission. That is the mission, very clearly. But that mission affects every part of society. So when we say that we want to change the world, we're not just saying that we need to go and get everyone excited about going to church, and that's all that matters, and then shut down every other form of culture so we can just worship all day. Ongoing worship is great, and what we do here is great, but true revival looks like people awake to their full identity and living that out in their house, in their workplace, in business, in media, in education, government, everywhere. So this whole vision, the vision that John had, this isn't about a literal city that people are coming into and they're leaving all their other cities behind. This is about actually filling the cities of this world with the true city of light. Does that make sense? So, by the way, this also means, another side note here to keep the repetition going, that we need to even treat unbelievers as family. Because guess what? They are. This is where the rubber hits the road in this message. Every single person is already clean in God's eyes. And last I heard, we're supposed to believe what God believes. Every single person is part of the family already. They just don't know it yet. They haven't been immersed into it yet, baptized into it yet, but they're still a part of the family. They're just estranged. So when we treat people like family, we see them that way, that changes how we interact. How you see people definitely changes how you treat people. And churches often become irrelevant at best, cult-like at worst, and inward-focused and split in between, because they think they're the special chosen few and the rest of the world is bad, and we're the high and mighty ones with all the answers. And again, we might not say it like that, but that's the naked truth stripped down right there in front of our eyes. And that's a problem. It's a serious problem because we are all family, and we are called to live as mature brothers and sisters. Mature brothers and sisters, as the sons and daughters of God revealed on earth. And you know what? Sometimes people in the world are more mature than people in the church, right? Yeah, amen on that one. But that is the calling on us, and the Holy Spirit will empower us through the gospel to walk as the sons and daughters of God. And that will ignite something in people's hearts. It will remind them of who they are. It will speak to their spirit. It will call them into the truth. It has an effect. You can have an effect on people. Absolutely. I had lunch with someone recently who went on a tour of the Navy and the Army, switched, and saw a lot of horrible things in the world. And I asked him, because at one point he was involved in a Bible study I was doing a long time ago. I asked him where he's at with God, and he's like, yeah, not anymore. I've just seen too many things to believe in God. And so I just talked with him. I just heard him out. We had a great conversation, and I encouraged him to just continue to have hope, continue to just know that God is at work. I went over some things in my own story. And he sent me a message a few days later on Facebook. And he said, Nick, I just want you to know that when I walked away from us that lunch, he said, I felt so light. He said, I felt this like happiness that I haven't felt in a long time. He's like, I think Jesus is in you or something. He literally said that. He did. I was like, that's awesome. That's awesome. I'm not tooting my horn here. I'm just saying this stuff rolls off. It has an effect on all of us. It really does. Okay, we're almost at the end of the session here, laying some very basic stuff down about our calling. But there's two more important points I want to make, that just to add on top of all of this. How are you guys all doing? You okay? All right. So this is key. This is vital for us to understand in changing the world, being that light, all of this. This great calling of ours is not restricted to one church or one ministry. Now, for some people, I know this might be terribly obvious, but for other people listening to this, this is something they need to grapple with a little bit more. Your calling to reach the world is not limited to your church or one ministry organization. It's okay to focus into something and sow into something. That's good. But here's the point I'm trying to make. Our role is to passionately, confidently express Christ in every arena of life. Family, friends, work, ministry, finances, health, etc. So our whole life is ministry. Here's the point, and I'll say it this way. Each of us is in full-time, lifetime ministry. Every one of us. Did you hear what I just said? Each of us are in full-time, lifetime ministry. You've been ordained. You might not have a nice little plaque like I got one in my office, but guess what? You don't need it. You're ordained. I need it to do weddings and stuff like that. And, well, I won't go there. But anyway, you're ordained. Your whole life is ministry. I am not in ministry more than you. Is this strange to hear? For some people it is, probably for some of you. I know why we think this way, because I get a title called minister, reverend, right? And I understand the reasons for that, but this could really actually be unhealthy when we put people like myself on a spiritual pedestal. It's very unhealthy for me and for you guys. The word minister, you know what the word minister means? It means to dispense a drink. It means to serve somebody. You all get to serve the wine of the gospel. You all get to serve the wine of love. You are all ministers. You get to serve that wine everywhere you go. And guess what? It starts in your home and it radiates outward, right? Now, somebody like myself, I might have a particular gifting to work in a spiritual community like this in order to provide some leadership, some guidance, some ongoing teaching. But my job is not more important than yours. Nobody is more specially called than another. You guys still tracking on this? I know that priests and pastors, they often sacrifice a lot for what they do. But guess what? A father who's a mechanic sacrifices just as much when he chooses to live a life of godly love. The mechanic is just as called as the celibate priest, and neither is higher before God. Please let that sink in. The pastor's role is important, don't get me wrong, but their role is to help others realize their role. So there's no full-time minister versus part-time. We got to learn to break these things down. That's part of what we're doing in this whole series. Breaking down old ideas, building up new ones. Each of us are full-time in every way. So here's the thread of this message, and to get into the last point. Before you go and change the world, you have to know you are a world changer, and you are a full-time world changer. Here's the last thing I'll say about this great calling that we have. We are not supposed to create a nice little Christian bubble for people to come into. What do I mean by that? Jesus called us to be salt and light within the world. We are to be a part of this world, a part of it. Because remember, we're all family, even if others aren't acting like it yet. We are here to be the joy, to be the peace, to be the love. Guess what all that means? To be Jesus in this world, right where people are at. And that is ministry, folks. That's it, very simply put. Let me give an example about what I mean by Christian bubble. I don't believe the church is called to make Christian music. Like, if we just had more Christian music topping the charts and filling the radios, you know, that would be a sign of the kingdom coming. The kingdom on earth is not Christian music, it's musicians who are Christ-like. Let me try to explain more. A musician, they might make great secular music. They may not even talk about God, but if it flows from a heart that is awakened to God's love, to Christ, they'll be glorifying him regardless. Here's another example. We don't need to have a bunch of official Christian businesses. And there's obviously a place for this kind of stuff. I'm purposely breaking down some things extremely to build up some new ideas. What we need is not just a bunch of official Christian businesses. We need businesses operating according to kingdom values. So we're not just creating this Christian subculture that's cool enough for everyone to fit into, you know? We're simply infecting the main culture with love, joy, and peace, and righteousness, and all that means. I really hope this is making sense. This is available to go over and listen to again, and obviously we'll be talking about it in different groups when we meet. But I just want us to be free to be who we are. And I don't want you to think that you have to have some official Christian label on things in order to make an impact. We need to be ourselves in this world, pursue our giftings and our passions, and learn to be Christ and bloom right where we're planted and fill the whole world with a garden. Right? By the way, even our church buildings, I don't even think they should be thought of as houses of God. In other words, as a temple, as these little holy places on the corner. Am I going too far this morning? Maybe I should back it up and quit while I'm ahead. I'm done here after this. Jesus ended the whole temple system. He ended it. I don't think churches should be thought of as, oh, that's the place you go to find God as though he's over here and he's not there. This is not the house of God. You are the house of God. You are the house of God. You are the house of Jesus. If anything, the church building is a beautiful tool that we are to steward and use for his glory. And you know what? Yes, communion and worship and those kind of things can happen here. But I really believe this should be a part of the community. It should be a place of healing for the community. A resource center, as we say sometimes. So I hope the distinctions I'm making are clear. The world doesn't need to be converted to this one giant Christianese system with church buildings on every block and Hillsong playing on every radio station. What the world needs is to be healed of guilt and fear and the lie of distance and separation between them and God. The world needs to receive the love of their dad, just to know they're his kids, and then live in the joy of that. And when that happens, guess what? The whole world becomes church. The whole world becomes sons and daughters, waking up, treating each other like brothers and sisters in Christ. It's that simple. And then that begins to change homes, schools, workplaces, everywhere we interact. We're not looking to take over this world. We're looking to infect it with love, to spread the seeds. I've said it all very clearly. I think you got the point. Jesus, let's pray. Lord, make real in our hearts, Jesus, make so real in our hearts, our divine calling. Our divine calling. Oh, precious Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, we pray so often for a revelation of our identity. And that is so key. That is where everything starts. But Lord, today I am asking that you would give us a spirit of revelation, that you would hit our hearts with the truth of our calling. Our calling as a light of the world. Jesus, raise up this place, raise up everyone listening as a lighthouse for your glory. We thank you so much. Jesus, we love you, we honor you. In your name we pray. Amen.